when you talk about the formal private sector, that means things like paying taxes, and we want people to pay taxes and follow environmental laws or labor laws. These are all good things. And if folks pay their taxes, you can pay for things like schools and education and police and roads and have citizen security. So these are all important things. So having a growing private sector is a really important thing. Well, it's not only the job of, there's certainly private enterprise and entrepreneurs and investors have an incredible role to play, but it's not just the private sector. It's also things like good governance, things like rule of law, some of the themes that we've heard about already so far, but there are also contributions that institutions like the World Bank or the Inter-American Development Bank or the U.S. government can make as well. So I wanted to bring together some thoughtful folks from different perspectives to talk about this very important issue and help set the stage for the rest of the conversation that we're going to have today. So I'm going to ask first Tom Pritzker, who's the chair of our Board of Trustees, but also given his important role at Hyatt, which is the global hotel chain, I thought you'd have a view on what does it take to enable private investment, but more specifically, two things I want you to think about. One is, when you are looking at a country to make an investment and you're going to build a hotel, what do you look for? And just talk a little bit about why should we care about the travel tourism sector? Because I'm very much in favor of it. I know you are too, but I actually think it's quite important for the future of development. So thanks for being here.
Okay, thanks, Dan. So let me start with the last one, give you a sense of the scale of the travel and tourism business. We are about a $7 trillion a year business. We account for about 10% of the world's GDP. We employ about 285 million people globally within our industry. So this is a very significant industry in any scale you wanna think about. We're in an interesting position because we can take an unskilled worker, bring them in, train them, and honestly, they have unlimited upward mobility. If you look, I actually haven't looked at it. I'm guessing if we looked at the top 50 people at Hyatt, 40 of them, 35 of them would have started at the front desk, having come in the U.S. situation with a college education, in emerging markets, possibly without a college education, and come up through the ranks, learn their jobs, and it's really your energy and your attitude that is the only ceiling that you face in the hospitality business. In Dubai, a couple other pieces of data. In Dubai, we have employees from 45 different countries in our hotels. In London, we have people from 40 different countries in our hotels. So we are running sort of a global enterprise, not just in the sense of the locations that we're in, but also, actually most importantly from our point of view, in terms of the colleagues we're dealing with. If you ever want a great experience, go to in Dubai, we've set up a housing area for our employees, and it's one of the great experiences I've ever had is going there, because you have these people from all over the world and they're working together and they're playing together and they're living together, and in that case it goes from the housekeeper all the way up to the general manager is who's living in these villages. We're also very much part of the communities in which we work. It's interesting listening to Steve talk about Chevron. When we go into a community, we sign a 30-year contract to manage that hotel. The result is we know on day one, everybody in the hotel knows on day one, we are going to be part of this community for our economic success. Our people's kids go to school in that community. We want to be and have to be part of that community. So what do we look for? Governance is an important factor. We need a certain level of stability. Does it have to be perfect? No, but we do look at that. We want to understand what that means And what's the probability that we walk into a situation that's okay today, and 3 years later we end up in the middle of a very chaotic environment? That can be tough road. We were in Iran when there was the transition from the Shah to the Ayatollah. We had people put in jail for years who had worked in the hotel. A legal system. Property rights is important. Respect for contract is important. Those types of things. Again, all of this has margin, but we need to have some basics. I'll tell you one quick story. This is in the days of Marcos in the Philippines. A competitor had a 30-year contract to manage the hotel. Owner was a friend of ours. He said, I'll give it to you guys. We said, you can't, you have a long contract. He says, no, I can watch. Called the general manager in, said, you're out. The general manager said, sir, I appreciate it, but page 24, we have another 16 years left on the contract. The owner pulled out a 45, cocked it, and said, I think your contract has another 30 minutes left in it. And so from my point of view, I look and say, okay, is that really something that we want to inherit? So legal systems is the second part. And then the third, you heard Steve, you heard the senator talk about hope. The way I want to frame it is attitude. Employee attitude is critical for us. What we're doing is we're not selling hotel rooms, we're selling an experience. Our purpose is to care for our guests so they can be the best at what they want to do. That's an experience, is how we think of it. The way we deliver that experience is through our employees. So we can train them, but this issue of culture and attitude and hope is really mission critical from our perspective. That's the too long version.
Thanks, Tom.
Dan, could I make a comment on Tom's industry? In the development community, there are times when it has been controversial whether the MDB should be investing in hotels. And I want to give an example of the catalytic power of the opportunity, the hope that you speak of. In 2010, I went to Accra, Ghana, and there was a brand new hotel. It's where the president had stayed on his trip, a competitor. And when you touched down at the airport, you could see the hotel. It was relatively close, but you also saw it because there was nothing else going on. I returned last year in transit to Liberia, and I looked for the hotel, couldn't find it because it was surrounded by office buildings, a new mall, additional hotels. It had been the catalyst. It had given business people a place to go where they could carry out their business. Was that the only factor? No. But I very much believe in the power of the tourism, the hospitality industry, to be one of the elements of sound economic development.
Thank you very much. We do see that. We do have a lot of examples of it where we can be a early mover and create a development within a bad portion of an American city or an interesting country that needs development.
Marisa, thanks a lot for being here, and thanks for your partnership with us at CSIS on a number of issues. I'm thinking of the doing business indicators in particular. And so this is, you've had a very interesting career. You've been worked in Massachusetts state government, if I can put it that way, Boston City government. You worked in state government in New York. You also worked for Citibank in past life. And now you're Assistant Secretary of the Treasury, and you oversee, among other things, the issues related to the multilateral development banks. You're the person responsible for, the U.S. is the largest shareholder of the World Bank, the largest shareholder of the IMF, the largest shareholder of the Inter-American Development Bank, JJ, so behave yourself.
I know her very well.
EBRD, and the U.S. has a significant share of the African Development Bank as well, not the largest shareholder.
We're actually number two in the largest non-African
shareholder. So you've got a really interesting portfolio. So you see this as well at the Treasury Department because of the Office of Technical Assistance, which deploys experts from Treasury, oftentimes in partnership with AID or with the Millennium Challenge Corporation, where they work with finance ministries or tax agencies. So you have both a past life in economic development domestically, and then you've had this really interesting life the last several years in your public service in the Obama administration. So talk a little bit about, when we think about what does it take to enable economic development, and what is the role of, say, what is the role of the U.S. Treasury, and what's the role of the MDBs from your experience as a shareholder?
Thanks, Dan. You've given a great setup of what it is that Treasury does. I also want to thank you for hosting this on one of the 5 days that I'm in the country in the month of May,
because we organized it around you.
This is the season when all of the regional development banks have their annual meetings. And so if my voice gives out, it's that I've spent a lot of time on planes. So as you said, my remarks are going to come from the perspective of being from a finance ministry, but a finance ministry that plays a very big role in economic development internationally. Now, when Treasury engages with less developed countries, we do it from two perspectives. One is to promote macroeconomic stability. And if I were at the IMF, that's the angle that I would focus on. But given today's audience, I'll focus on encouraging private sector-led inclusive economic growth. The global community's thinking about this took a giant step forward, or I'd say a leap forward, last year at the Addis Ababa Financing for Development conference. Dan, you mentioned the domestic resource mobilization. Equally important was the agreement by both developed and developing countries that the private sector investment was a critical facet of growth. Now, I'll focus on two facets that drive private investment. The first is the investment climate, and particularly the investment climate for developing infrastructure. And then the second is access to finance, and I'll focus especially on financial inclusion. So on infrastructure, when you think about infrastructure, the first thing that comes to mind is the projects, the roads, the bridges, the ports, the power, the telecoms. But equally important is the soft infrastructure, health, education, and I'd say the even softer infrastructure, what you refer to, rule of law, governance, accountability. Now, in Treasury, we work across the spectrum from super soft infrastructure to hard infrastructure in partnership with our MDBs. And we do it bilaterally through the Office of Technical Assistance. We do it multilaterally through the MDBs. But we also take it global, and we do it through the Group of 20. So I'll touch upon those three different dimensions. I appreciate your shout out for OTA, our Office of Technical Assistance. But I have to say, I've begun to take it for granted. It is a small program. It's a gem that punches so far above its weight. And when I joke that I take it for granted, it's because foreign finance minister, one after another, just sings the praises of these technical experts who are not there as policy folks. They're embedded in the revenue authority. They're embedded in the finance ministry rolling out a single account. They're doing hands-on projects. So OTA's traditional expertise is public financial management, be it revenue collection, debt management, bank supervision, countering money laundering. But the concept of public financial management is a pretty elastic term, and in response to the requests from our client countries, we've added infrastructure finance as a specialty. We're working, for example, with Indonesian government to increase the capacity of their ministries to roll out renewable energy projects. In Peru, the government realized that it didn't have the capacity to analyze the economic sustainability of some of the infrastructure projects that they were developing with the private sector. And so we worked to get them to be smarter. Now, the second dimension in which we work is with the multilateral development banks. One of the things that we're really pleased by is that the MDBs are looking to leverage their balance sheets. I know financial engineering can be a bad term in some circles. This is smart financial engineering, in which they're looking at how they can use their balance sheets, their current balance sheets, to provide more funds for infrastructure. I'd give a particular shout out to the Asia Development Bank, which was the first mover, and the Inter-American Development Bank and the World Bank are not far behind. But it's not just about the dollars to implement the projects. Equally important is project preparation. And sometimes funds for project preparation can be a lot harder to find. The World Bank is focusing on this through the GIF, the Global Infrastructure Facility, which focuses upstream by looking at the investment climate, but it also focuses downstream by looking at risk mitigation tools that will help the private sector feel confident that they can invest. Now, taking it to the global level, the group of 20 leaders have turned their attention to infrastructure and have set up an infrastructure and investment working group. What is the value of the G20? It is not the implementing agency. That is done in the field, that's done by the MDBs. But when the G20 leaders get together, those are leaders that control over 80% of global GDP. And they're saying that an issue is important to them attracts the attention of folks around the world. The G20's particular focus, not surprisingly, is regional infrastructure connectivity, moving beyond the borders of one particular country. So my second topic is going to be access to finance. There's an emerging consensus that financial inclusion is a necessary element of economic growth. It's a high priority for the Obama administration, not just internationally, but also domestically, because as the senator pointed out, we have challenges within our own country. We have people who are the unbanked, who don't have safe, reliable, affordable access. What I have found interesting as someone who spends my time outside the US is that in the area of financial inclusion, we domestically are learning lessons from what developing countries are doing, and I think it's great when knowledge flows both ways. Now, once again, we deal with financial inclusion through OTA, the MDBs, and the G20. At OTA, again, we were driven by the requests of our client countries. We had central bankers coming and saying, I don't know how to supervise the informal financial sector. So we helped them draft the laws and regulations that can bring the casas de cambios into the formal financial sector. We're also modernizing government payment systems, in particular for the delivery of benefits to the poor within countries, as a way that this touch with government can bring a woman within the formal financial sector. At the MDBs, they are increasingly including a financial inclusion module or facet within their broader programs. They provide technical assistance, and they also gather data. One of the key values of the MDBs is the fact that they have access to data which, well, I'll point out the World Bank's Global FinDex database. That is data publicly available that can then be used by policymakers to have evidence, to have a basis for informed policymaking. Finally, I'll end with the G20 and what they're doing on financial inclusion. One, they've raised awareness of it, the fact that these leaders have the ability to shine a spotlight on a topic, but they've also developed the G20 principles for innovative financial inclusion. Most recently, they are focused on digital financial inclusion. And I'll give you a preview of what I would expect to see at this year's G20 meeting, which is seeing a call for countries to develop country-specific plans for promoting digital financial inclusion. Now, Dan, you mentioned that I had worked in the city and the state level. I think that there are two major takeaways or similarities that I see, regardless whether it's New York City, New York State, or the city of Boston, or a sub-Saharan African country. The first is the value of community involvement right from the outset. And that was, your story was a graphic example. Community involvement in thinking about a project, the design of it, but all the way through implementation and operation of the project. The second, and it's somewhat of a corollary, is the importance of having consistent support across different administrations, across handovers in government, not seeing a project start and stop because the political party that has taken over the presidency in the sub-Saharan African country has changed. I'll give the prime example of it. that I was fortunate to be involved with, the redevelopment of 42nd Street. It spanned four different New York City mayors. For three of the mayors, it was a headache. For the fourth, it was a crowning jewel. And that lesson of continued political support is equally important for building a hydropower dam, let's say in Cambodia.
Yeah. Thanks, Marisa. I never thought anyone would ever use the term regarding any activity I ever did as a teach-in, and you described what I did for the doing business indicators as a teach-in, so thank you, I think, for that. But I see part of my job at CSIS is stopping stupid things from happening, and there was a moment where they were going to try and kneecap or kill the doing business indicators, which obviously the Obama administration disagreed with as well, and so I was really happy to partner with you and with others and a lot of thoughtful people to stop something colossally stupid from happening. So you were talking about data, and this is one of the, sort of the crowning pieces of data are the doing business indicators. Let me just reflect on just two other things. I think this issue of access to finance, I mean, I think the important thing, when we think about formality, which is a technical term that's often thrown around, formality means that people can get a small business loan or get access to a credit card. Formality also means you can grow a business beyond two or three people by going accessing the formal banking system. And that's an important part of, I think, when we think about the concept of formality, that's an important part of it, to your point. And let me just make one other point about infrastructure. We've done a lot of work here, especially in the last year or so, or last year and a half. I think for us, a real wake-up call has been the AIIB, the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. I think there's a before and after the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. And I would say, in addition to throwing money at it or having money for feasibility studies, and I think these are all important things that G20 are doing. I actually think the biggest challenge is two things. One is making sure you have a capable public sector to actually manage really complex infrastructure. And so I actually think it's actually a public administration function as opposed to even more private sector investment. And I think one of the other things to watch in the future is because of the change in the World Bank's procurement rules, it seems like a super obscure topic, but it's kind of all, you know exactly where I'm going with this. They're moving from the VHS version of procurement rules to the DVD version of procurement rules that's going to include life cycle costs. Well, why does this matter? Well, it means it's going to require a lot more capable public sector government officials to make very sophisticated decisions about infrastructure in the future that aren't just based on what you'd call a low bid. It's about taking into account a whole series of other factors. So yes, resources matter, but also capable governments matter. So thanks, Marisa, for being here. Okay, JJ, thanks for being here. You come from one of my favorite countries, Spain. I lived there. I love the country of Spain. You served in Felipe González. So you served in Felipe González' government in the Ministry of Finance. I worked on international issues in the Ministry of Finance for Felipe González. You also had a past life at one of the great money center banks of the world, Banco Santander, which is one of the largest investors in Latin America. You currently have a day job as chief economist for the Inter-American Development Bank. As I think everyone here knows, the Inter-American Development Bank is not only an important development player, probably the most important development player in the Americas, but also has, I think, a unique form of almost sort of moral authority. And you guys are able to work with a whole spectrum of governments. I won't characterize them or provide my opinion about some of these governments. Some of them are really bad. I won't name names. But you actually interact with everybody from A to Z, so you guys have a lot of influence that others, sometimes in the United States can't, you guys can. So here's my question for you, which is, okay, there has been an incredible amount of growth in the last 10 or 15 years in Latin America. Why has that happened, and has the IDB or MDBs played a role in that?
Yeah, thank you, Dante. It's a pleasure to be here speaking on behalf of the IDB. And I think I will pick your comments about me and these three steps in my life to try to convey you some ideas about development. Let me begin by saying, I am the first generation of Spanish people who has seen during his job life GDP per capita in their country multiplied by 6. When I joined the job market in Spain back in the last century, Spain has a $5,000 USPPP GDP per capita, and now it runs around 30. First generation in maybe since the 13th century. I have been the first generation of Spanish people who has been able to belong to a global executive class. We were very isolated, and now you have these big Spanish companies, which are global companies, and I belong to the to Banco Santander, and during 17 years, we were building the largest financial network in Latin America. We invest there $100 billion, which is really a big amount of money. And I am the first Spanish to perform as chief economist in the IDB. I have a way to look at what has happened in the world in the last 30, 35 years, and I will try to convey what I have learned. Let's begin by the early years, Spain. What led Spain from $5,000 to 30? A lot of things, but let me put very clear what I think are the prerequisites. First, democracy. The second, it's a society having a common purpose. The Spanish society in the 70s, in the 80s, wanted to be European, wanted to integrate in the world, wanted not to be different as has been in the last 200 centuries. And this is important. And leadership. And the combination of democracy, a common purpose of your society, and leadership, you still can tell the story of Spain, just talking about Adolfo Suárez, Felipe González, José María Aznar. This leadership is very clear. And all this comes to a single word, consensus. The capacity to build consensus to frame policies. If you ask me to give you an heterodox idea, heterodox lexicon, I will see that much more important than the quality of policies is the quality of the process which leads to have a policy. Because once you have very good process to reach policies, you can be sure that these policies are going to be sustained and are going to change the behavior of the economic players, the social players. This is my first reflection on the first years. The second reflection about what leads a small bank in a small country, isolated country, to become a leader, a financial institution in Latin America and in the world, in Europe. I think, of course, you need something that you have to say. You need to have an ambition. If you don't have ambition, you don't go outside. You need to have skills. That's are something like push factor. But what are the pull factors? What leads a ambition company with half skills to go and to invest $100 billion in a region that is not their own region? I think two or three things which are also important, and not all of them are economic ones. The first is the sense that you share some culture. We share language, we share history with Latin America, and this was really a comparative advantage against other financial institutions. But we also see and anticipate that what in Latin America was going to happen was the emergence of the middle class. And they will need to have financial services that we can provide because we have the same culture. We have done this before in Spain, and we were in a very good position to cater them with in their financial needs. To go there is easy, but what you ask to decide to go to Chile and not to go to Paraguay or not to go to other countries. I think two very important prerequisites. Marisa Lagos commented the first, macroeconomic stability. You are not going to invest in a country which is a mess because this is going to play for disaster. And this is very important. Macroeconomic stability, it's really a precondition for foreign direct investment. And if you want to attract foreign direct investment, the only to offer very high rates of return is not going to be enough. You need to give them a horizon to forecast and to be sure that they are going to survive there. And you need the rule of law. But let me be very clear about the rule of law. I love one sentence I heard to George Gordon Brown some years ago. And Gordon Brown say, rule of law, it's really a prerequisite for everything. but the first 500 years to establish the rule of law are the hardest. And I share a lot.
Some minor detail.
The sense of this sentence. You need some. You have to ask rule of law, but you are to be ready to make a very big effort of understanding and pacing, because rule of law is not going to be the rule along your life. And therefore, and this is the third prerequisite for foreign direct investors, you need to be sure that you have the financial muscle and the support of your shareholders to go through bad times. Because if you are investing in emerging countries, you are going to have very bad times from time to time. And this is very important to have understanding and have the patience and have the financial muscle to survive this way. Let's go to the last question, my present incarnation as chief economist of MDB. I think that the most important thing that I will ask now to MDB is the capacity to adapt. I think that we are in a world in which MDBs, development banks, are going for very, very classical banks, something like brick and mortar banks, to something that is going to be a much more complicated. We are moving from the traditional bank, we just offer capital to finance infrastructure, hospitals, roads, schools, to knowledge bank. It's the, Marisa make a very important point. You can find the finance to get a road made. What is important, it's to have the knowledge to know where you have to do the road, how you are going to build the road, what is going to be the maintenance of the road. All these factors are very important. And to decide if you need before a road, or you need a hospital, you need a school, or you need a reform of your labor market. And this knowledge now we have huge reservoirs of knowledge in the multilateral institution, which has been working with the emerging world for the last 50 years. And this knowledge bank, I think it's going to be the future. Why? Because the emerging world, it's completely heterogeneous. Same from the IDB, Haiti has nothing to do with Brazil and the needs of Brazil. Chile has nothing to do with Guatemala. And you cannot give your customers the same services, because your customers has completely different services. This is the first adaptation that the multilateral have to do. Go from brick and mortar to knowledge bank. And the second very big transformation is when the multilateral banks were created in the 50s, 60s, the scarce resources was capital. And governments need capital to finance projects and make their policies. Today, I think that multilaterals has to look at what is the driving force of development, which is the private sector. And you have to move from institutions which are focused just in governments to institutions which cooperate and leverage the capacities of the private sector. And I think this is a very important movement, a very important transformation. We are living just to end my comments, in a different world by different reasons. Multilaterals were the only kids in the block in the 50s. Today they are not. The old multilateral, the World Bank, the IMF, the Asian Development Bank, the ADB, okay, we are there and we are doing our job. I think we are doing a very good job, but other competitors are appearing. We are talking about the Asian Infrastructure Bank, you are talking about CAF, you are talking about private capital markets, which are there. And how we look and we adapt to these new competitors, we have very different conditions and constraints that we have. I think it's important. We are owned by governments. We have faced a lot of difficulties to increase capital to this institution because they have their own constraints, domestic and political constraints, And we are facing new competitors which don't have these constraints and which can grow faster than we are able to grow just if the status quo is contained. This is an important thing that we have to think very thoroughly about that, because this is going to be one of the framing or the determining of the future of the all multilateral banks, which capital we have and how we can leverage the capital, how we are rated by the rating agencies, and how this idea of optimizing the capital, it's in fact among our capabilities or it's outside our range. And the second, we are living in a completely different world. We have learned that it's not enough to invest in roads or education or health to reach development. This is something that is no longer true. We cannot bet our money on these ideas, a simple idea that there is a single road, a single path to development. We need to realize that development, it's the interaction of many factors, many investment, it's health, it's education, it's roads, it's good governance, it's a vibrant private sector, it's a united society, it's an ambition. These things are very, very important. And we need to make the management of this diversity in a way which is efficient. And we need to create a much better governance in our institution to deal with these issues, because the present governance is not very well prepared to make the priorities and the tough choices that you need to do if you want to put these priorities, these investment priorities and choices on the table. I think that all what I have learned at the end, if you ask me just one word, it's how to discuss to reach agreements. If you don't have agreements, if you don't have a common vision, a shared vision of what you have to do, either in the government, either in the private sector, either in the multilateral institution, you are not going to deliver the result that the people are expecting from you.
Thank you. Steve, thanks for being here. You all make investments for the long haul, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. I suspect you guys have the ability to reach agreements with all sorts of actors, community actors, governments, national governments, and you have worked in a whole series of countries. You've worked in Myanmar, you've worked in Vietnam, you've worked in Indonesia. So I think you've worked in a whole diverse set of contexts, and so really welcome your thoughts about what does Chevron look for when it looks for a counterpart when you're making an investment, and what are some of the factors that keep you in a country?
Well, generally, the presence of oil and gas.
That's a minor, right? That helps.
But beyond that,
that helps, right?
I'm sorry.
I
couldn't resist.
Of course, we're in a think tank, right? We ask theoretical questions, and you bring it down to the practical level. Thank you, Steve.
But beyond that, so when we go into a community or a new country, and we did some exploration offshore, you mentioned Liberia. Historically, we would go in and we would establish a business, and then we would turn our focus to the community and what the needs were after we had a sustainable business there. We've since evolved now that from day one, a term we use a lot is called engagement, and that's engaging the host government, the communities, our partners, how do we create that sustainable business environment and that healthy business environment in the country. So in Liberia, one of the things that in discussions with President Johnson and her ministers and the communities, again, another country emerging from years of conflict, civil war, there was no way you could not do something that was constructive. But Oh, as I mentioned in my remarks earlier, one of the things we have learned is that we have the most success when we are focused. And while we are sympathetic to the many, many needs, we try to identify what are the most critical that we can have an immediate impact and bring some stability to that community. In Liberia, it was healthcare. And we helped establish some medical clinics. We purchased and had delivered and installed some medical equipment that helped with diagnosis. And again, we're focused on things that are plaguing that community, in which a lot of us in the developed world look past, because those things are polio or diseases like that. We tend to think those were the 1940s and 50s and things like that, but they're very real in many parts of the world. And even though our exploration efforts there weren't successful, that led to an oil and gas development, we have left behind, and we're very proud of the fact that we left Liberia in our small way better than we found it. We left some sustainable health equipment, trained providers, service providers, and brought in some international partners like NGOs that are focused on delivering health care, that will continue to deliver that after we have moved on. In a country where we have a sustainable business, we've learned that engaging the communities, the governments, the stakeholders is a prerequisite to long-term sustainability. The communities often know what their priorities are, and we've learned, as I mentioned the story about the school in Nigeria, that it's kind of helpful to ask them what they think their priorities are. And then in terms of selecting partners, Dan, if it's a school, we have lots of talented engineers and scientists, and we can construct buildings pretty readily. Not so much when it comes to establishing an education curriculum, training teachers, making it viable, making it competitive, making it serve the needs of the community. So we try to attract partners who have specific skills in education. We definitely want the host government involved and have, to use the expression, skin in the game. We want them to have some commitment to the project. We want to set it up on a basis that at some point it's going to be self-sustaining and not dependent on pure philanthropy forever. If it's a healthcare project, one of the ones we did recently is back to Angola. We partnered with Baylor College of Medicine from Houston, Texas Children's Hospital, and we sponsor young doctors. And we sponsor them for a 2 or 3 year commitment to go to Angola and work with medical providers there and teach them how to educate, diagnose, and treat sickle cell anemia. And the goal there is, over time, the Angolan medical community will become self-sustaining. So there's no one thing that we have to have. It's depending on the community, the needs, what we're, if it's health, it's education, it's economic development. We try to choose an array of partners that bring things that complement our skills and are not necessarily duplicative of what we think we bring to the party.
Okay. Thanks. Okay, I've heard a lot of really interesting points about what it takes to enable private enterprise. I've heard about leadership. So I think JJ talked about leadership and consensus. And as soon as you talked about Spain, I thought of also Colombia. I think of some like an Alvaro Uribe or a Santos. If you look at like what's happened in the country of Colombia in the last 15 years, that's a result of political leadership. I think the role of infrastructure matters, various kinds of infrastructure, soft infrastructure, education, health, but also this really soft or super soft infrastructure of rule of law and accountability. Having economic stability matters as well. So there are different ways in which the AIDs of the world, or the Treasury Departments of the world, or the MCCs of the world, or the Inter-American Development Banks of the world, or the World Banks of the world, have a contribution to make in making some of this happen. I would just ask each of you might just reflect on, you work with different agencies in different ways in terms of What do you think is sort of the most important thing that these institutions do to help further that? Maybe I could ask you, JJ, first, because when you think about what the IDB does, what is the most important thing that it does to help further economic development? Is it this advice? Is it advice more than money? Is it your ability to kind of be a trusted partner? What is it that you think is the most important thing that something, an institution like the IDB does that helps further that?
I will say that the most important thing is countries in Latin America and the Caribbean knows that they have some partner, which is a trusted partner, which has the knowledge and can help them, independently of other consideration. You can go there and to say, I need to fix my security problem. What do you have to offer me? And what has happened in other experiments in Latin America? And you have the knowledge to advise them, but also you have the money to lend them and to agree with them how to develop this mm-hmm. policy. But the idea that there are someone who is interested in them, I think it's even more important than the money and the advice you can put on the table.
Okay.
It's that there is something there, okay. That something takes care of them and can help them. I think this is a very important. You are the friend of last resort.
Exactly. You are the friends of last resort. Tom, thanks for being here again, and you were really engaged on our development council a couple years ago, and you've shared some thoughts here, and I know you've worked with AID, you've interacted with these different institutions in your different lives. You certainly think there perhaps needs to be some changes. I agree with you in terms of how we've given that we're in this change world. When you think about, when you look around the world, and you're either in as your participation through the council, but more likely through wearing your Hyatt hat, what do you think is some of the most important thing that these institutions provide from what you see when you're out there, whether you're in India or you're in Africa or you're in the Middle East? What is the most important thing?
So looking at the world through my prism, I sort of think jobs and growth are the key to everything. If you've got vibrant jobs and growth, you can address all the other issues that are equally important, but jobs and growth enable addressing those. Wearing strictly my Hyatt hat, we work with these institutions. It's primarily for financing. We tend to be pretty good at being able to build relationships and understand cultures. If we're anywhere in the region, we will be able to make the connections. For other businesses, that's not the case, and that is an important role, is making those people connection. Sort of going beyond my Hyatt hat, I think where these institutions can be very helpful is helping countries think through strategies to help with their development. Not sort of the narrow, siloed approach, but what do you got in your country? How can you develop your country, because not all countries are the same, and then helping them, yes, there's a money component, but equally important to my way of thinking is the strategy itself, introductions, putting people together, teaching them about the industries that you may be talking about for the development of a particular country.
So what I'm hearing so far is it's not necessarily about the money. The money matters, the money's a vector, but it's about trust, it's about brands, it's about expertise, it's about helping provide strategies and being a helpful interlocutor.
The money is at the back end of it. You need the money to do all of this, but if it's only about money, it's less likely to be effective.
Okay. Marisa, is it about the money?
Money is key, but what I was struck by, Dan, as you were describing the range of participants, I think the important thing to focus on is we're part of an ecosystem. It's an ecosystem that includes government and public institutions. It includes the private sector, the multilateral development banks, and I would add one additional major facet, which is civil society. Yeah. And I think one needs to have all of those elements. They need to coordinate, they need to recognize what is their particular expertise and when is it appropriate for them to get out of the way. But without the entire ecosystem, I don't think you get sustainable development. You don't get the jobs and growth.
Okay, Steve, so you all have worked with AID, you've worked with other institutions. What do you think is the most valuable contribution that these institutions make?
Well, I think it probably echoes what the other panelists have said, Dan. I mean, obviously, in some cases, they bring much needed financing or monetary resources to an issue. And that can be from, you know, in a country, the country wants their national oil company or energy company to be involved in a large project. And it's often difficult for them to obtain conventional financing for their share of the capital necessary to develop that project. And one of the truisms of our business is that you often spend years developing an energy project and billions of dollars of capital against no revenue, absolutely no revenue, because it's very difficult to do some of these projects where you do one small phase and you start producing revenue. So that's one thing they bring. But the other thing they bring is organizational skills, management practices, transparency, rule of law expectations, and they help us convey our expectations to our partners, the host governments, the communities, that while we are willing to help and we're willing to invest, we do have some basic building blocks that we need to see. We need to see, you know, a proper management structure in place for a community, whether it's a community project or an infrastructure project. We need to see transparency. We need to see a path to communicating those results to the stakeholders such that they can understand, you know, here's what our expectations were, here's what our investment were, here's what the results were. What did we do well? What's our opportunities for improvement? So in many cases, beyond the obvious things that multilaterals bring, like financing and things like that, they bring reform to business practices, rule of law, transparency, and just basic management and skills that societies need as they grow and they have their issues become more complex.
So if I'm thinking of AID, or I think of the DFIDs of the world, or I think of the Inter-American Development Bank, or the World Bank, or the Asian Development Bank, a big part of their bread and butter is the fancy term policy dialogue, which basically means going and talking to government ministries and convincing them to make a decision. My view, having been in the business a while, is it's a lot more powerful conversation if you're interested in policy dialogue. If you're the largest aid donor in a country, to have the largest investor in the country, or a series of investors in the country saying, if you make this change, these folks are going to make these kinds of investments. So if you care about policy dialogue, if you're a development person, it's a lot more powerful if you've got someone, whether it's a multinational energy company or a hospitality company or a financial services player at your side saying the same thing. So I think it's money matters, the resources matter, but it's about the credibility, it's about the trust, it's about the expertise. Ultimately, though, I just want to leave this group with this, that we are a minority shareholder in other people's dramas. We are supporting actors. We are partners. We are trusted partners. But it's ultimately about the leadership, and it's about the societies taking the agency of their own destiny, or taking control of their own destiny. So we can help, but ultimately we've got to have good counterparts on the other side. Well, look, everyone's been very, very patient. Please join me in thanking the panelists. Thank you.
This was fun. Thank you.
Really good.